Tell you a little bit about 1 million cups, why we do this every Wednesday, what it's all about. I see some familiar faces, so I know maybe you have already heard this spiel. Some of you already know the drill, what we do here. But it's pretty cool. We've been doing it now for, I think about 4 years now in Dallas. And we have chapters all over the U.S. And you can see kind of on this graph a little bit about how it's grown. I think there's, what's the current number, about 150 plus cities around the U.S. that do this every Wednesday. So it's kind of cool. If it's your first time, you should note that this event is going on simultaneously in all of those other cities across the U.S., so that's pretty cool. Thank you for the shout. excited. This is really my time to practice my stand-up comedy. No, you can't. I don't think stand-up. All right, so next. We do have a cool app called the 1 Million Cups app, and you can download that. It's free in the App Store, and it enables you to check into the event and also connect and sort of network with the other attendees, as well as the startup founders that are on stage. And you can see all of the past presenters through that app, which is pretty nifty. And you can give them feedback. So if you're like, man, this guy really bombed up here, you can actually tell me through the app. And you don't have to say it to me in person. Emmanuel.
Let's be honest.
Yes. Okay, so today's presenters, we have the agency project. Daniel is here presenting. Is Chad here as well? Okay, so Daniel and Chad are going to present for them. And then Step School Chef as well. And about halfway through, we're going to take a little pause to thank our sponsors. Some of them you already see. The deck, obviously, the Dallas Entrepreneur Center is our venue. Kurtu, creating these amazing Transylvanian treats from Vampire Country. That's what I learned today. And that's it. So we'll start with the agency project. We'll bring them up on stage, and then you'll hear about our other sponsors halfway through. Let's give a big round of applause.
Well, first I want to start by saying thank you for letting us present 1 Million Cups. We really appreciate it. I want to start quickly with our founding. So in 2015, it started as a side gig at a traditional ad agency, really focused on trying to drive early, young talent opportunity from a leadership standpoint. By 2016, it started to shift into a core mentality and insight around really disrupting a traditional model, right? We're all familiar with the agency model. By the end of 2016, unfortunately, or fortunately, depending on how you look at it, I got laid off with the agency losing some business. And by 2017, it became full-time. I actually met our first two clients in the elevator of an unfinished WeWork on a hard hat tour. So it's kind of I want to take a second to explore the old model for those who might not be familiar with it. One, a traditional ad agency tends to be geographically constrained, right? Both from a location standpoint, a client standpoint, but also a talent acquisition standpoint. They also rely on a perk-based culture in order to keep and maintain that talent. And they also have to rely on an agency-level experience, not individual talent within the building itself. The last thing that I want to point on with the traditional model is the fact that they really rely on a new business, what I call rush, right? So they get an RFP, and all of the best ideas tend to come from that initial relationship. Unfortunately, in that case, as we'll see, it's not the A-team that executes, it tends to be the college grad. There's a few core operational problems with this, right? It's very capital intensive. You need a minimum scope in order to even open the door. Like I said, it's perk-based, when people really only care about flexibility and getting paid. There's significant talent churn because of industry niche experience. There's less opportunity to find new opportunity, new clients, new. And then finally, like I said, it really relies on a new business mentality versus an execution mentality. currently agencies of the futures are really just rebrands of the traditional model. They are still bound to the elements that we discussed earlier. And it's an antiquated model that is really primed for disruption. So what we're doing, we're not just rebranding the traditional model, we're actually redefining how the model works with three simple philosophies. One, our people are global, both in location and mentality. Brands do not pay for overhead, just the work that's being done. And we only profit as a company when we perform. It's all driven by an asset-light, tech-enabled infrastructure of not freelancers, but extraordinary talent. We're professionalizing what, by current standards, tends to be an unprofessional network. And it's really formed around a core operational structure. One, in the center being department heads that you know, we've vetted, that we are really partners in this model. A board of advisors, really higher level, industry-based professionals that can drive strategic growth. On the outside of that, you have the actual talent network. Currently, the talent network sits at about 100 to 120 individuals across the globe, ranging from India, China, Argentina, several in the US, several in Canada. We believe that it doesn't matter where you are, we just want the best talent on your team. And it's all connected with three core ideas: mentality, community, and benefits. So first, we look for a mentality, which drives community engagement. But as a group, if we have a combined culture and a combined, what I like to call talent culture, we can drive benefits. We can partner with companies like WeWork or the DAC, or we can partner with Microsoft Office and offer a suite of benefits that freelancers today have yet to be a part of. And in 2017, we proved that the agency is not just a concept. On the left, your left, you have just a quick snapshot of our Slack channel. Like I said, we have about 100, 120 people in the network. At any given point, we have roughly 25 to 30% daily participation of that network in the community, creating a knowledge base for the agency. So looking ahead real quick, this is our projected revenue for the year, effectively. So we've seen some significant growth since 2017, and it's relatively simple. We're currently raising a seed round to help really build out the back-end infrastructure for managing the talent. To date, it's really all been manual, but we require a lot of steps before you're actually able to get into the network doing client work, which leads in, again, to the admin interface development. And then also diversifying the revenue stream. So as an agency, we don't want to just partner with brands. We can do things like, for startups, become the internal marketing department for investor relations. We can also actually become an incubator. What brands don't realize today, or agencies don't realize today, is that they have the talent. It's just a matter of leveraging the talent to do that.
So we'll move forward with the Q&A. So we have 15 minutes of questions and answers. I'll be getting it. If you have any questions, just raise your hand and I'll come to you and make sure you speak into the mic. Okay. So before we go to the public, the first question as always is, what can we as a community do for you?
Yeah, so I think the biggest thing, I think a lot of people come up here asking for money. Really, that's not what we're looking for. I mean, we're raising, but what we're looking for is actually the best talent, right? I mean, our agency is predicated on finding and maintaining the best talent. So if you know anyone, that you think could be a fit for joining our talent network, it's everything ranging from brand and strategy and growth consulting. Chad helps a lot with the growth consulting right now. All the way through creative execution and development and design and analytics and media. So really the whole spectrum, it's just a matter of finding those people.
Okay. So it's open to the public.
Cassidy Johnson here. Great presentation.
Thank you.
Concept. From my perspective, so is this more of a, you're professionalizing freelancing?
Precisely. I love that you said that, yeah.
Okay.
So off that, the traditional freelance baggage is a non-professional group of people. The idea is that we can bring them together in a way that's a professionalized, accountable, service-based company.
I'm assuming you have some consistency in your principles and ways of executing, right? Because if you're going to help a brand or a company with strategy, the execution piece has to kind of flow with that. If I'm going to, say, take you on board as our branding strategy piece, or how are you kind of getting that piece consistent throughout the freelance community that you're utilizing?
Yeah, so one of the things we do to drive community and loyalty, because the biggest thing with I hate saying freelancers, but just for the context, freelancers is there isn't a lot of loyalty and there's a lot of issues with maintaining, to your point, consistency across the board. Freelancers all of a sudden can't complete a project and you have to go find someone else to do it. What we like to do is we actually like to provide a security from a retainer basis and a performance compensation basis. So as an agency, we negotiate performance compensation with the client, but we pass through that as well as the retainer to the freelancer. So it's effectively their client and we're just maintaining the cohesion and the consistency across execution.
Hey there, I'm Michael. Good job. For a guy that doesn't know much about agency world and the ad world, nice job explaining the old model and the new model.
Thank you.
So what I would also like to hear is, since you've got revenue, you've got clients, right? As you showed on your graph of making revenue, somebody's paying you. So I'd love to hear in your story, maybe you could give us now, tell us one great story of how y'all executed, delivered, the values there, they're super happy and it worked for everybody in the mix, so that you can really give an example of this new model and why it's better.
Yeah, so I'll start with Thrive and then I'll go into Carnival's. Two quick examples. So Thrive Plus is an alcohol, after alcohol aid. They called us a week before they were going to air on Shark Tank and effectively said, can you rank us for Thrive Plus Shark Tank? Because Thrive Plus is a very competitive keyword. We effectively spent the next, call it 72 hours, just constantly re-indexing and updating their site, so by the time it aired, it was, I don't know how we did it, like they actually ranked for Thrive Plus Shark Tank. It helped that they had some press releases, of course, but I think the back-end technical stuff that our team was able to do in such an efficient manner helped offset some of the lack in timeline. Carnival is another example. They needed inventory on their site. They're a used car marketplace. So we put together a growth hack strategy around getting and targeting people who currently sell their cars on site. So we were able to scrape a bunch of different platforms, classified platforms. So by the end of the campaign, they had more private inventory in Dallas and Houston than competitors like Car Gurus at a cheaper cost per acquisition compared to like Carvana, almost like it's like 10% that Carvana's cost per acquisition.
Hi there, my name is McKinsey.
Hi,
McKinsey. There are similar services like this, like Upwork and there's tons of them, there's a handful. Assuming you're aware of those. What makes Tap different than
So that's a great question. We're not an Upwork. Upwork is effectively brands using a platform to connect with freelancers. What we're doing is we're professionalizing the entire process of working with freelancers. So we're a full service ad agency. So when a client works with the agency, we have a process in place that allows us to get super smart about the brand, but then also allows us to vet and bring on the people we need to in order to deliver against the scope. And that allows us to then negotiate performance compensation. So what we're driving is effectively talent loyalty for continued execution across a longer term relationship. Versus an Upwork that's I'll post my project and hopefully get a good design or good deliverable within 1 to 6 weeks.
listened to your presentation about the agency work that that you do. There's tons of agencies in Dallas. Dallas is probably the agency better. And it's also probably talent mecca for a lot of different people.
Say that again, sorry.
Talent mecca, as in there's a lot of people that are in the creative and marketing space that you can utilize. So how do you plan to grow? Because I saw that you mentioned diversifying your revenue streams. How do you plan to compete with some of these other agencies, and what's your growth strategy?
Yeah, so we had to fight, or we're currently fighting the perception when we pitch brands that we're a cheap agency, because we do come in under like significant retainers that local boutique shops are coming in under. The reason why we can do that, like I said earlier, is we pass through 95% of the upfront retainer to the freelancer. So we're actually getting better, more experienced talent working and executing on the brand than a lot of the traditional firms in town. Not saying that those firms are bad, it's just a different model. So what we can do is we can take a person with 20 years of experience, have them execute and, you know, come up with a strategy, or come up with a strategy and execute for the same, if not cheaper, than, you know, the salary that they're getting at a boutique shop. So that's our competitive edge, is because it's pass through, we're not taking any of the middleman fees, which increases obviously the scope of the retainer. In the traditional model, you also have to remember that a large chunk of the upfront retainer goes towards paying for the glass building that they're working in, versus the actual talent on the account.
Thank you. My name is Wael. You talked about diversifying revenue stream.
Yes.
You oriented a startup because of the fact you're asking for seed funds, I mean, although you have been in business for some time. So how do you think that diversifying or stepping into a new product or new revenue stream is going to distract or take away from the focus that you need as a startup on what you're doing right now? You know, where's that balance? And you have like a roadmap or a timeline?
Yeah, so I think the biggest way we can diversify revenue, because in the end, we can say that we're white labeling our services. So for startups, we actually have several startups who I'm technically the VP of marketing. It's all an investor relation conversation at that point. That doesn't mean I'm a full-time employee for that person, but effectively, they're just hiring the agency. The core opportunity for revenue diversification is around the incubation platform we're trying to build, which is leveraging we have a great group of talent that are supporting current value, e.g. current brands or startups, whatever it might be. What we want to do is we want to eventually build out a team or build out teams that are creating companies within the agency to spin off and become their own companies to support themselves, like go raise money or drive revenue.
But how long down the road do you see that?
I see our
because
first.
The reason I'm asking is when you are in a model of a startup, at least in my book, you probably need to focus for a little while on your first product and get into a steady state of your operation before you start distracting your attention somewhere else. So that's really my question.
Yeah, totally agree. So what we're doing in 2018 is going to be ideally our first like minimally viable product, and it's based around the admin interface, which is something that we can sell to other companies to help manage internal talent. Does that make sense? So that, in a sense, it's helping us and letting us focus, but it is a way for us to prove out the incubation model for the long term.
Hey, my name's Kurt. To follow along, McKinsey, right? So are you a technology company, or are you really an ad agency, or are you trying to bridge that gap and be a project management platform like Upwork?
Yeah, so it's a good question. It's a little bit of both. I'll give the example of Door Homes, right? So Door is a tech-enabled real estate firm. So it's a service-based company that has leveraged technology to improve the operational function of a traditional real estate firm, is effectively what they've done. They're doing things quite differently, but the model that they have is very similar to the model that we're trying to leverage for the marketing industry as a whole. the traditional real estate firm or traditional real estate industry, you either have a big firm with a building and you're managing commissions and a team and all that good stuff internally, or you're working with a local, you know, side project real estate firm or agent. There was no real hybrid model that got the benefits of a team with the cost savings of maybe a friend that also does real estate. So our whole model is around improving the efficiencies and the operations of an ad agency to better scale opportunity and scope, right? So everything from the local startup or local mom and pop shop, we can put someone on that. We have the talent to deliver against, you know, what you need versus the big, we'll never work with a Fortune 50 company, I don't know if we ever want to, versus like a Coca-Cola where we can put the 150 person team on that to drive the global market.
So I have a lot of voice. So one follow-up then. So would the ideal customer of yours be an actual ad agency providing outsourcing?
No. So that is a way we can diversify revenue. It's something we've really thought about in terms of current agencies have a hard time staffing or can have a hard time staffing new business as it comes in because it's still not big enough to hire, you know, five more people. So what we can do is we can come in and give them the talent they need to execute on the scope that they are trying to deliver and have a partnership model in that way. So effectively, we're white labeling our talent under their agency to deliver against new business. It's a little bit risky for the agency because if we don't deliver, it's their name on the line, but I like to say that we're going to deliver. Our true ideal customer is actually the younger marketing director at a small cap company who's super dynamic, super diverse. We don't want the entrenched VP of marketing who's worked with the Richards Group or WPP holding companies for the last 20 years of that person's career.
So we have time for one last short, quick question. I lost one more.
Well, besides money and talent, what else do you need? I mean, we have a lot of questions on the business case.
Yeah.
As you want to build out your business, and so you're a young entrepreneur, what are the other things that you need?
Money's always good.
Yeah. I mean, money's great, right? But at the same time, we're really growing organically, and the model allows us to grow without needing like huge influxes of cash. If anything, we're probably going to shift the round towards more of a venture debt round versus a venture capital round. But really, I mean, it sounds, I don't want to just repeat my answer, but like talent is the biggest thing because what we've seen in the traditional freelancer has a lot of baggage, right? They like can ghost, they, you know, their rates can be disproportional to the time that they're putting. Amazing people, individually wonderful people to work with. They're global, they got a different mentality than like a full-time person, they're entrepreneurial with spirit. The issue is managing that network in order to deliver, to an earlier point, consistency. So really, our core need and the one thing we're focusing on is continuing to bring on people into the talent network. And we want to scale that to roughly 500, 600 people in the network by the end of the year. Because that then allows us to take that group to like Microsoft and get like a big corporate discount against Microsoft. So I know I just repeated the answer, but really my focus is talent.
Thank you. Well, thank you, and let's have a round of applause for it.
Thank you.
Awesome job. All right, now I'm going to give a shout out to our sponsors since we're halfway through. So from the left, we have Michael K. Bruner Productions, who runs our video and is also part of our volunteer team at 1 Million Cups. So if you need the ideal photography, hit them up. Our venue here is the Dallas Entrepreneur Center. If it's your first time here, you're welcome to talk to Emmanuel or one of their staff members. There's Emmanuel waving in the back. If you'd like to get a tour or get more information about the deck. Our coffee sponsor today is Brazen DFW. And if you haven't heard of them, I'm going to give a little plug for them since Jasmine didn't get to be here this morning.
but do we have any female entrepreneurs in the room by show of hands? Okay. And by another show of hands, anybody who knows a female entrepreneur? All right, so that's pretty much over here. And that's the great thing about Dallas. And so Brazen invites growth-seeking female entrepreneurs at all stages of business and industries to join a like-minded community, access curated online and offline resources, leverage best practice tools, and feel supported on their entrepreneurial journey. Brazen DFW will officially launch on April 24th. And for more information, or if you'd like to become a founding member of their organization, you can check out www.brazendfw.com. So that's thank you to Brazen for being our coffee sponsor. I think we'll probably have Jasmine come to one of our future events, maybe next week, to give more information as well. And then lastly, High Brew Coffee. They provide us with their coffee once a month, and as well as Kurt 2 again. So are there any more left over there? Yeah, looks like there's a few left. So please do grab one if you haven't tried those yet. So thank you again to all our sponsors. And next up, I'd like to invite Toria to come up to the stage, our second presenter, with, here we go, the School Step Chef. A standing ovation as well. Thank you all on stage.
The Kid Culinary Challenge associated with the White House. And then a little bit about me. I am a top MBA turned marketing executive turned entrepreneur. I have tons of experience in the food industry where I have led large brands and businesses, as well as led innovation and new product development for multiple clients. But that's not really what people want to hear. People really want to know, how did the Step Sous Chef get started? So it actually sparked in 2011. It was like the coldest day of the year. You guys remember, those of you who were here, it was when Super Bowl came to Dallas, right? And we got shut down for the snow.
No accumulation.
Not right. That, it looked like this was our front yard, right? And it also happened to be Julian's third birthday. And we had to cancel all his plans, and so, but fortunately we had enough to make a homemade birthday cake. And so, as you know, typical, I started to make the homemade cake, and he came to me like a 3-year-old would and said, "Mommy, I can do it." And so we grabbed the step stool and his chef hat, and with a little assistance from Mommy, he made his own birthday cake. And I can't tell you the pride and joy that he felt from that experience of independence through cooking. And that was the spark that began an amazing journey with the Step Stool Chef. So ever since then, we've worked with some of the top chefs in the country. We've partnered with some amazing brands. We've been featured on network television multiple times. And we've also launched an online cooking school for kids, as well as a cookbook. Now, one of the things people come to me all the time, they say, "Oh, well, you know what? Your kid really must love how to cook." Now, if you haven't figured it out by now, my co-founder is also my son. And I tell them all the time, no, every kid loves to cook. I have yet to meet a kid that doesn't love to cook. In fact, food is one of the top sessions for kids over music and sports. The challenge is most parents aren't cooking with their kids, and they're not leveraging it as an opportunity for leadership and development. And that's the core difference for the Steps to Chef. We want to leverage cooking as a safe space to create confidence and empowerment and self-sufficiency for kids. But parents aren't empowered. So not only do we have to empower the kids, we have to empower the parents and create solutions to make it easy and turnkey for them. And that's why we are now pivoting our business into a new, more scalable phase where we're focusing on creating a cooking kit for kids. It's an all-in-one meal kit and culinary solution that allows for us to provide not only the meal, but also the skill. So in each kit, we'll be focused on highlighting a culinary lesson where it will be anchored on how to cook a certain, how to build a certain type of culinary skill. As well, we will include all the ingredients and tools to make a meal where you can practice those skills. So we're integrating the lesson with the meal. And we also have an opportunity to partner with a well-funded startup out of Shanghai to create the Steps to Chef home app that will allow for us to supplement that culinary lesson experience through how-to videos, step-by-step recipes, as well as more culinary lessons and how-tos. So for example, in each kit, it would include access to the mobile app, the ingredients that you need to make the, and the tools that you need to make the meal, as well as a hands-on activity and culinary lesson. And so, one of the things that I also want to highlight is that we have a kid advisory board in which we want to make sure that this and a product is made for kids by kids. So all of our recipes and all of the things that will be included in the kit, be kid curated and tested. We're excited about this space because right now, if you look at the meal kit industry, it is highly geared towards adults, and they are not taking advantage of this explosion of kid in the kitchen kind of revolution that's happening. And the things that are focused on kids are completely underestimating their capabilities and only focused on just the tools or the activity. We feel as though we have an opportunity to meet that white space. And we want to do it in retail. Because what we've noticed is that the current meal kit industry is being slowed down and hindered by the subscription-based model. And specifically for parents, they want to be able to
So our first question, of course, what can we as a community do for you?
All right, three things. So the three things that I'm looking for at this point, like I said, we're actually in the idea phase for our business. We are for this particular part of our business. And so we are wanting to transition to make sure that we create more scale to this opportunity. This is a big idea, and we have the right team and the right expertise to do it, but we do need partners. We actually need to gain partnership in a couple of key areas. One, kind of in the beta testing space, would love retail partners where we can be able to partner and execute this idea for our better beta testing, as well as a creative and digital solution where we can outsource some of that because it's becoming a bottleneck for us. Our digital and creative is, I'm a bottleneck in that process. And so I know for the where we want to go, really needing solutions to be able to do that. And as highlighted, the freelance model is not sustainable for us at this point. We also are looking for feedback on funding options. I have a CPG background, of course. It's next natural for me to create a CPG product. But it's hard being a CPG girl in a tech world. And even the resources here with the deck, as great as they are, is very tech focused. And so just trying to get feedback on the right ways to really support it. I've been bootstrapping it to this point, but to get to where we want to go, incremental funding would be definitely necessary.
Awesome idea, awesome energy. I have a two-year-old, my wife's back there, honey. We gotta pick up one of these at-home cooking kits. Tell me how that works, by the way. I have a lot of questions I'm going to talk to you after.
Sure.
I think we can help in terms of partnerships.
Awesome.
But I want to understand the retail model. So do I go and that kit that, I don't even know if that exists right now, but my son's getting to that age. So Would I pick up a kid and it gives me all the instructions, we would do it together? Is that how it works?
Absolutely. So included in the kit would be the recipe, the ingredients, as well as an activity card and a parent guide to make sure. So we currently have a version. So we have an MVP version that we've sold so far. And the biggest question we get is, when are you going to create more of these? And so it would be a turnkey solution where you can pick up. That's why I'm excited about the retail option, because it would allow for parents to be able to pick it up. And a lot of these purchases are driven, you know, not just by impulse, but just a curiosity. And so we want to be able to link in on that curiosity and create a solution where you have. So our current model right now is also doing non-perishable ingredients. And so, for example, one of the first kits that we want to do, which is real ideal for retail, and so one of the first kits we want to do, for example, is learn how to make your own bread. And so in that particular kit, you will have the ingredients to make two types of bread, a quick bread, as well as a yeast bread, as well as the step-by-step recipes, the learning guide, the lesson guide, and the parent guide, so that you can actually teach your kid. It's an in-home cooking experience. And what we're also hoping to do is supplement that with the with access to the Step Sous Chef mobile app, where you can get access to the curriculum and the how-to videos, which is modeled by our Step Sous Chef Academy.
Hey, Toya. I'm Michael.
Hey, Michael.
Nice job.
Thank you.
Got kind of jammed up on time there. Did you finish, or were you?
Actually, I picked up.
Okay. All right. Perfect. Wow.
I got comfortable at the end.
Okay. Good. So, no, I love the idea of this. I think I also think about in the LMI community, low to moderate income community. Are you thinking about serving that community where it's also about really bad food and bad home habits for how they're, you know, feeding their kids and all that kind of thing? Does this have a play there, or you think about that market at all? Does that
yes.
make sense?
So it would be one of the things that we are trying to incorporate is more partnerships. So it'd be more of a partnership model versus a direct serve model. I know it's tempting to want to do the one-for-one model, but I think that it really is an opportunity for us to get more entrenched. So for example, two weeks from today, we are partnering with Baylor Medical Facility and participating in their fundraising, which is all about serving that particular community. So there's ways that we can serve that community in conjunction, is integrated into our business model.
Cassie Johnson, again, great presentation as well. I have a 2-year-old, and so he's getting to the point where he's in the kitchen with my wife all the time. Are there gonna be differences in the types of kids age-wise, so a 3-year-old versus an 8 or 10-year-old?
No, that's a great question. Our target market, which I didn't have time to get in here, is ages 5 to 10. And so there definitely needs to be some level of self-sufficiency. We did have an idea, again, like I said, my business partner is a key contributor to our product development ideas, and his suggestion was that we have a learn how to make your own no-bake solution for the toddlers. So our priority is to launch with 3 to 4 SKUs that's catered to the 5 to 10, but definitely he's given us feedback that we need to come up with a SKU that will serve the younger market.
Okay, my name is Mackenzie. I kind of have 2 questions, but one is a little clarification about, I love the 1 Million Cups app, by the way. I'm looking at your website through it, so I'm coming through it and seeing that what I see on your site currently today is a little different than all that you're saying right now.
Correct.
So does that mean, here's the question, is this coming out, or when is this coming out and ready to be launched versus what you're showing
correct
here?
So right now, this is why we need partnerships. So I've been able to accumulate the right partners in certain key areas, right? So I have a partner. So let me back up. One, yes, this is a pivot for our business, to clarify that. Two, what we have is the foundations to be able to launch, but funding is one of the, and a beta test is one of the things that's going to be able to dictate our time at this particular point. We do have key partners that will help facilitate this, and we have the right resources to make this happen. If someone came to me today and said, I want to launch, we have the resources to make that happen. We have the right POPAC partners that's actually local, that provides non-GMO and sustainably sourced ingredients. We also have a partnership with Side Chef. We've been partners with them for 4 years, and they've already agreed to create the mobile app. In fact, I can show you a test version of the mobile app. We already have ingredients and recipes, and it's an active model as we speak. We also have partnerships with other vendors that will help us commercialize it. At this particular point, like I said, we're looking for a beta test to launch it, as well as an agency partner to help us relaunch our site.
Okay, so the timing of those things is when you'll launch all these new ideas?
Correct.
Okay. That was one that I need to clarify. And then, what was the second one? I already forgot my second one, so never mind.
My son tells me to rub my ear when I forget, and it helps me remember. It does, weirdly enough. You've heard that too, so it's not just me.
Hey, my name is Rocky. I have a 2- and a 5-year-old. I think it's a very important topic, especially in today's era where we have childhood obesity, and more and more data is showing that the trajectory of later onset hypertension, diabetes, has really started from eating behaviors from early on. The struggle I have with kids, my kids, is they stick to a very specific diet. Usually it's the sweeter the better. They're fickle eaters. I know parents across the board have a difficult time getting nutritious meals on the table that they would actually eat. Are you trying to create some ideas that will engage how you can get a more nutritious product other than just trying to help them maybe make a cake or something like that? Or, something that the parents would be more comfortable of wanting to be repeat customers and say, like, I can ensure that the kids are at least getting nutritional value out of this. At some base minimum. Is that something you guys are creatively working on, or is it more about just empowering the kids to do stuff for themselves as a project?
So our primary focus is about kid leadership and empowerment. That is one of the things that we are focused on. A secondary benefit of what we're doing, of getting kids in the kitchen, and this is just scientifically proven, when kids cook their own foods, they tend to eat it, right? And so a lot of our ingredients that we want to include are all making an ingredient from scratch. So for example, one of the kits that we want to provide is learn how to make your own soups and sauces. So this would include working and teaching the kid how to make a sauce from scratch, how to make soups from scratch, how to make a ABC vegetable soup from scratch, right? So these are all things that the benefit that will happen just by product of them cooking for themselves is that they will tend to eat the healthier foods that they cook. So while our focus isn't saying make your kid healthier, we acknowledge and recognize that that is something that is a byproduct of when kids cook for themselves.
Have time for one more question. Anyone?
Can you tell us, because I don't think I heard it, why did you leave the corporate world and decide to go into entrepreneurship? It seems like you were doing very well in your career from what I've seen, and I've heard you on podcasts, so I actually know the answer.
Oh,
I believe.
Wow.
But I'm asking for everyone else.
You Googled me.
Yes, I did. Thank you.
I'm trying to tell which version of the story. Yes, to the point, I actually had a very successful career. I worked for PepsiCo for 10 years, where I raised through the ranks and got some amazing experiences. There's two parts as to why I left my corporate career. One, I created a career where I became an anomaly in my space. I created new business models. I created new business propositions for the company and created new growth models for the company. And so I recognized that for me to create the career that I needed to go outside of the walls to do that.
So in addition to doing stuff through Chef, I actually have a marketing consulting business called Hatch Venture Group, where I help companies hatch new ventures. And I can do a little post about that too, but that's but the reality is that I also, on the personal side, I also had a five-year-old who is now 5 year old. I had a new daughter. And I wanted to find a way to be able to be the professional that I wanted to be and the parent that I wanted to be. And I wanted to create a new business model that worked for me in order to do that.
Thank you.
Okay, well, great presentations today by both companies. Who's inspired by some of that? That's my preacher bit. So thank you again to all the sponsors for making this happen. We had Brazen DFW is our coffee sponsor this month, so thank you to them. BrazenDFW.com is their website. To Pertu, to the deck, Hybrew Coffee. Who am I looking at? Where's Michael? Michael K. for doing all of our video and photography. And everyone who's here in person attending, so thank you guys also for sharing on social media. If you don't know, we also do have a YouTube channel where all the content gets posted, so you can see the entire videos from each week posted there if you had any more ways you wanted to follow up. And then, lastly, I'll just say, please do stick around afterwards. We'll turn the music back on. We'll get to network. Both the presenters will stick around, hopefully for a little bit. You can come say hi in person and ask any questions that you didn't get to. So with that's a wrap. And thank you for coming out. We'll see you next week.